When I was a very small boy, I had a great love of the sea, and my ambition was to be a sailor. After I left school, of course, I was very keen to go to sea, but I'm afraid that didn't cut any ice with my parents, and they were not keen on the idea at all. Eventually, after many, many tries, I obtained a job as an ordinary seaman on a ship sailing from Glasgow to Ireland, the south of England, and the Bristol Channel, and my day was made. Now, I was really very fortunate on this ship because the bosun was a very, very fine man, and he taught me a lot of things regarding seamanship and all sorts of wee tips to make life bearable aboard the ship. My great day came when he insisted that I would go up onto the bridge and try my hand at steering the ship. That was a red letter day for me. I was enjoying my work and was promoted to able seaman. This was a red letter day for me too. Now I was able to play my part along with the other seamen, take my turn on watch of steering the ship and also the lookout, and also I was joined them in painting and scraping and keeping the brushwork and the ship clean. Now, as I considered at this time that I was a qualified seaman, I decided that I would spread my wings and wanted to join some other ship going further afield. This would be about 1922 or thereabouts, and I well remember on my way to Russia sailing through the beautiful Kattegat and Skagerrak between Denmark and Sweden. After this episode, I joined a ship sailing to ports in South America from Britain. Now, these ports were mostly meat ports where we loaded tins of bully beef and all sorts of meat, bonus herries and places like that, and took them back to Britain. When we arrived back in Britain, I decided that I had put in enough sea time to warrant me going to the Nautical College and studying for my First Officer Certificate. After some time at college, I felt satisfied that I was able to take the examination in the Board of Trade offices for my First Officer Certificate. I was very pleased when I received this after the examination. At this time, of course, there was a lot of unemployment in Britain, including shipping, and I was very, very lucky indeed to obtain a first officer's position on a small tramp steamer which went here, there and everywhere. I stayed there in this little ship until I had qualified, as far as time was concerned, or sea time was concerned, to warrant me going to Nautical College again and sitting for my Master's Certificate. After spending some time in Nautical College again, I went to Board of Trade Office again and took my examination for Master's Certificate and was very pleased to obtain it. However, at this time, unemployment in Britain had got really very, very much worse, and officers' jobs in British shipping were very hard to come by, and I was unemployed for a long, long time because even captains were sailing as seamen in those days, And though I was unemployed for quite a few months, I felt myself really lucky in obtaining even a second officer's job in a small tramp steamer. However, unfortunately, this didn't last long because unemployment and shipping were getting the worst way, and I was soon paid off from this little ship, and the ship was laid up in the Tyne, where I was expected to stand by the ship and be a glorified watchman. Now, as I was young and had my master's degree, I didn't consider this a good thing at all, so I had to go ashore and I was unemployed again. As a last resort, I thought, well, I've heard of the Clyde steamers. They're sailing regularly now. I said, I wonder if there's any chance of getting a job on the Clyde steamers. So I wrote to London and North Eastern Railway Company asking them had they any position in any of their Clyde steamers, as I had a master's certificate and much sea experience. Much to my surprise, a few weeks later I received a letter from the London and North Eastern Railway Company saying that if I was prepared to take a first officer's job, they had one on their ship, the Lucy Ashton, lying at Craigendon and sailing regularly on the service between Greenock and the Gairloch Piers. After a while, I got used to the Lucy Ashton and became quite fond of sailing up and down the Clyde on the Lucy Ashton and meeting passengers and having grand conversation with different people. It was a different life altogether. So I decided that my future lay with the Clyde steamers, and I remained on the Lucy Ashton. Now, although I said that I had a different life on the Lucy Ashton altogether, that's quite true, because the Lucy Ashton was a paddle steamer and she carried about 1,100 passengers and holidaymakers, plus four cars. Now, there were no car ferries in those days, and the only means of transport was by the Clyde steamers. But we had to make sure of the tides, because to get the motor cars aboard the ship, we had to open up the gates at the paddle box, put two large cargo planks out from the paddle box onto the pier, and drive the car up onto the deck of the ship, making sure she didn't do any damage in the road up. After a time on the Lucy Ashton, I was becoming quite used to the life on a Clyde steamer, and I was transferred to various of the Clyde steamers and sailed in most of them, all paddle steamers, for instance the Talisman, the Kenilworth, the Marmion, Virginia Deans, Waverley. I sailed in them all and was getting to like the life more and more as I sailed in them. Of course, the bigger ships like Dunedin's and the Waverley, they went further afield down to Campbellton, Drissig, round Isles of Craig and all that, and the experience was terrific that I was getting there. And to mingle with all the happy passengers in the summertime, especially at the Glasgow Fair, was an experience. Now, the paddle steamer Waverley that I have just referred to was built in 1898, and she served as a minesweeper in the First World War. This was the same ship as served as a minesweeper in the Second World War and was bombed at Dunkirk. After spending another number of happy years on the Clyde steamers, unfortunately, the clouds of war started rolling in and my outlook became darkened. And in September 1939, it was decided to lay up all the Clyde steamers. But before doing that, they had an important job to do. That was to evacuate all the children and nurses and people like that from the big industrial areas, Glasgow, Greenock, Dumbarton, all over and put them in the small resorts in the Clyde, like Inverary, Dunoon, Brodick, Rothsay, all the famous Clyde Pier resorts. The children from the big cities were evacuated at this time. Now, it was a pitiful sight for me to see coming aboard my ship all the little children with labels strung round their necks and wee cases. This was them going away to spend, we didn't know at that time how many years, evacuated to the coast. But they were all very happy and seemed to think they were going on a holiday. All the Clyde steamers, when they were finished with this exercise, there were only three connections in the Clyde now for the Clyde steamers. And that was the one between Gourock and Dunoon, one between Rothsay and Weems Bay, because there had been a submarine boom built between Gourock and Dunoon, and no ships could pass down except through the gate of the boom. This was to prevent German submarines coming up the river. And the third one was down between Ardrossan and Arran. After a while, the Waverley and the Marmion, LNA airships, on the instructions of the Navy, who had taken them over, wanted them sent up to Ingalls' Yard in Glasgow and Partick to be converted to minesweepers. To comply with the naval instructions, I took charge of the Waverley and sailed her up to the Partick Yard of A&GI Ingalls, where she was to be converted to a minesweeper. Well, in Ingalls' Yard and going round the Waverley with the Admiralty overseer to see about all the things that had to be altered and stuff that had to be taken ashore, he asked me, would I be willing to sail on the Waverley and take charge of her after she was converted to a minesweeper, and I would be given the rank of lieutenant. I agreed to do this, and now I was a naval officer. Now the overseer was keen on putting all the beautiful teak seats, passenger seats that we had on the deck of the Waverley. He wanted to put them ashore as he considered they would be much use on a minesweeper. However, I was adamant that they should stay aboard because these seats were actually life rafts. Underneath the wooden seat, there were metal rafts, which were really life rafts, and we had what we called lifelines rigged all round the seats with loops on them, and anyone who was in the water could cling to these ropes and they could float for hours if necessary. Now, I was adamant that these seats should be kept, and as it turned out, later on, they were to be of immense use in saving life. One beautiful afternoon, while carrying out these duties, we received a sudden message, Admiralty signal, to proceed to Yarmouth and there to fill up to capacity with stores, ammunition, oil and water and anything that we needed, and then proceed to the mouth of the Thames to receive further orders. We arrived at the mouth of the Thames, beautiful evening, and we received our shield orders, and when opening them, I was directed to proceed with all haste to the beaches off Dunkirk at La Panne and evacuate as many soldiers as possible. As we approached La Plan and the beaches of Dunkirk, we saw a great big glow in the sky and we just wondered what that was. However, after we got over a bit further, we found out it was flames shooting up into the sky from the buildings and oil installations of Dunkirk, and they had been pounded by German bombers, and the sky was a glare of red and yellow flames, and everything seemed to be on fire ashore at Dunkirk. When daylight came in the morning, a beautiful clear morning, and we were astonished to see on the beach thousands of soldiers all lined up in orderly columns waiting for someone or something to evacuate them. Now, at the same time, we discovered that there was quite a number of other ships had come in during the night and kept quiet and didn't show any lights the same as ourselves. So it became a hive of activity then. We immediately started the evacuation. Well, we're doing this for some considerable time and everything was going quite well, but it was a slow process. So I decided that I would send a thick rope ashore onto a stake in the sand and tied to the ship and let the soldiers who were coming back in the boat, instead of the seamen rowing or trying to row in a very cramped space aboard the lifeboat, the seamen would pull themselves on the lifeboat into the ship by their hands. Now, this went very well because they pulled themselves hand over hand and we got on with the evacuation much quicker. While the evacuation was going on, I was standing in the deck watching the soldiers coming aboard in very, very orderly fashion and very disciplined, and I saw two or three small soldiers, and I immediately came to the conclusion that they were the world-famous Bantams, and of course they belonged to the HLI Regiment of Glasgow. And one was talking away to the other, and all of a sudden he looked round the boat and he saw me and he said to his pal, "Hello, Willie, this is old Waverley, we're going away for a trip to Rusty." And I was very, very much moved by that, because here were these soldiers, they had come, well, I imagine they'd come through hell getting to their evacuation point, and there they were aboard the Clyde steamer Waverley and talking about journeys to Rothschild. Well, the evacuation was going very smoothly now and everything seemed to be peaceful and quiet, but during the course of the morning we had seen a plane, we couldn't distinguish what kind of plane, very, very high up in the sky, but we surmised it must have been a German reconnaissance plane. Well, shortly afterwards, our doubts were solved as to what kind of plane it was, because a swarm of enemy planes came over and started bombing the beaches and the ships trying to carry out the evacuation. So we knew then that it was a reconnaissance plane all right, and they'd sent for the German Air Force to come and attack the ships. Unfortunately, a lot of the soldiers on the beaches were bombed and quite a number killed and wounded, and some of the ships damaged, when we got word from the commander of the convoy to stop evacuation and proceed with the convoy to England. Well, going to join the convoy under naval protection, we discovered that one of the ships, the Oriel, had gone ashore. Now, this was an old Clyde steamer and was called the Eagle III in peacetime. So we knew all of the crew aboard, and they sent a signal asking us could we possibly come and try and take them off the beach. So I was in a bit of a dilemma now, because I would have to send a signal to the commander of the escorting ships asking for permission to take the Eagle off if I possibly could. So I sent the signal, and he decided to leave it to myself to make my decision. So I left the convoy and proceeded to the Eagle, the third, to try and take her off the beach. Now, we tried quite hard, but our ropes and the gear that we had aboard the ship weren't sufficient to move the Eagle, and regretfully, we had to give the attempt up and leave her to her fate. It was a beautiful day now, sun shining brilliantly, and the convoy were very, very much ahead of us, and we could hardly see them at all. In fact, they were out of sight very soon. At the same time, we couldn't see any planes, and everything was very quiet and peaceful. However, that didn't last long. Suddenly, we saw a squadron of German planes coming full speed and making towards us. There were about 12 of them, as far as I could gather, and they passed down each side of the ship, firing their machine guns and some overhead dropping bombs. Now, I must pay credit to the soldiers aboard the ship. They kept firing their rifles and trying to keep the German planes away. I must also pay credit to my own crew, because all the armament we had was a 12-pounder gun on the bow and two twin Oerlikons on the paddle boxes. And my crew were magnificent. They kept firing away and firing away with these guns. However, the planes were too many for us, and eventually we were struck by two bombs. One put our steering gear out of action, and one went through what used to be a beautiful saloon in peacetime, and we were using this as a sick bay. Very shortly afterwards, we were struck forward of the bridge by another bomb, and I knew the ship was doomed then, because she started to sink rapidly. So I gave orders to abandon ship. I was still on the bridge now as the ship was sinking, and I stayed there, not because I wanted to be a hero, but I was dead scared and didn't want to go in the water. Of course, I was unable to swim. And I thought to myself, well, there's many sandbanks around here. If I try and get the ship onto a sandbank, she may not sink altogether. Part of a superstructure, including the bridge, may remain above the water. This might give me a better chance of being picked up. However, the ship went right down and I went down with her. But, of course, having the life belt on, I shot to the surface very quickly, and by luck I was very near one of the life rafts which I mentioned earlier on, and I clung to one of these life rafts along with a whole lot of rescued soldiers. It was then that I discovered that most of the German planes had gone, but there was two German planes, one on each side of the life rafts, firing their machine guns at the rafts and the soldiers, and killing quite a number. There was a little soldier beside me who had been talking away quite a thing while hanging on to these life rafts, And all of a sudden, all I could hear from him was, ah. And he floated away dead. He had been struck by German machine gun bullets. After a while in the water, clinging onto these rafts, we were very relieved to see a squad of small fishing boats. They were coming not from the beaches, but from the town of Dunkirk, and they were going to pass very near to us. Now, our hopes were buoyed up, and we all started to shout and make as much noise as possible, and luckily, the fishing boats heard us. Now, one came alongside the raft that I was on, threw us a rope, which we clung onto, and were hauled alongside the fishing boat and hauled up on deck, where I collapsed right away. I recovered after a few minutes. I was really very exhausted and was very gratified to find that this little fishing boat was going back to Ramsgate. She had come from the town of Dunkirk, also on a rescue mission. The reason why she was so short of provisions was that she had already a full complement of survivors from the Holocaust of Dunkirk. Of course, I was soaking wet by now and very cold and uncomfortable. I decided to try and get a warm place to dry myself and maybe get a little rest. I went in through the door above the engine room and discovered the grating above the engines, and it was very, very warm. So I lay down there after taking my jacket off and dried myself as best I could. Later on, I fell asleep. I was awakened by one of the crew of the fishing boat. He told me they had been sent out from England along with several small ships to do what they could in the Dunkirk rescue business. But unfortunately, a fog had come down and they were now lost. The captain had asked him to ask me to come on the bridge and see if I could help him out. I was making my way to the bridge when all of a sudden I bumped into my chief engineer. Now, I hadn't seen him since the beaches of Dunkirk when the planes started attacking us. And oh my, the relief and joy that I found at seeing him, and his relief and joy in seeing me, were unbounded. So with a bit of a yarn, and then I explained to him that I was going to the bridge of the small fishing vessel. Maybe in about half an hour, maybe 3/4 of an hour, the fog lifted very quickly and beautiful sunny day returned to us. Much to my joy and pleasure, I discovered that we were very near the Goodwin Sands light vessel. Now, that was a good mark, and from there we knew how to make our way to Ramsgate, and away we went and arrived in Ramsgate about half an hour or 3/4 of an hour later. As we stepped off the boat at Ramsgate, glad to feel the soil of England under our feet again, we were directed to the naval offices. There we gave a full account of what had happened to the naval authorities and were directed to the naval doctor for an examination. We arrived there and the naval doctor immediately said we were unfit for further service and decided that we would both have a fortnight's leave. But he was puzzled by one thing, because I had taken my jacket off and my shirt, and on my bare back several small scratches which seemed to have closed up. I think that was the effect of the salt water, and the doctor was very puzzled. until I showed him my jacket and the small holes in my jacket and decided that it was bits of shrapnel, very small pieces that had pierced the very heavy jacket and scratched my back, but it was nothing serious. We were given a voucher or travel warrant to take us from Ramsgate to Glasgow Central via Euston. We arrived at Euston in time to catch the night train to Glasgow, and we immediately looked for a first class carriage that was empty, and we were very, very glad to stretch out on the seats and hoped we would be left in peace and quiet until we reached Glasgow. After arrival at Glasgow, I took my fortnight's leave and thoroughly enjoyed it, and then got orders to proceed to Drossin and take over command of a flotilla of deep sea and Bear Island trawlers. Now, they were minesweepers, and they were sweeping from Drossin to the west coast to the north coast of Ireland each day, and were based at Drossin. We continued this work for quite a while, and then we had a special assignment. We had to sweep from the Cumbrae Heads outside of Millport to the northwest coast of Ireland, which took us about 3 days. We anchored at night, whatever was convenient. One night we anchored off the Isle of Craig. But the idea was to sweep these convoy routes thoroughly, because they had started sending the Queen Mary and the Queen Elizabeth, the two big passenger liners that were quite new, with troops to the Clyde. One would leave New York and one would leave the Clyde alternately, so that we had to sweep one ship out over to the west of Ireland and wait and sweep another ship in to the Cumbrae Heads in the Clyde. A short time after arrival at the Drossin, I was ordered to take my ship and another of the minesweepers up to Oban, as apparently an RAF flying boat, which had been in submarine patrol out in the Minches, had crashed in Oban Bay, and they had no idea where she was down, and they wanted us up there so that we could trawl for the aeroplane. When we arrived in Oban, we immediately proceeded to trawl and see if we could find the crashed plane. Eventually, we did find the plane, and we marked it by putting a couple of buoys over the spot where the crashed aircraft was lying. After another short time in the Clyde, I was sent to New York to take charge of a flotilla of wooden minesweepers being built in several yards over there for the British government. Now, I say wooden minesweepers, and that's because that this was supposed to be an answer to the magnetic mine. When all the ships were completed and ready to go to sea, we had a few days working up minesweeping exercises outside of New York in the open sea. When this was completed, we were ready to sail for Britain. We duly arrived at Londonderry without any serious incident and reported to the naval authorities there. I was told that I would be escorting with the flotilla a convoy of merchant ships to the Mediterranean. At this time, apparently my spell in the Mediterranean was up, and I was sent back to Britain to take over a post as assistant minesweeping officer in Swansea. Because although the war is over now, mines were plentiful, and any officer that had any minesweeping experience was quite valuable now and was kept in service as long as possible. At the same time as returning to England and taking up this appointment, I was informed that I had been awarded the Distinguished Service Cross, the DSC, and I was presented with this in due course by King George V at Buckingham Palace. After some time in Swansea, I learned that the London and North Eastern Railway Company were building a new Waverley on the Clyde to replace the Waverley that was lost at Dunkirk. And at the same time, I received a letter from the Marine Superintendent of the company saying that he wished me to take command of the new Waverley when she was ready for service. Could I get my release from the Navy? I managed to get my release from the Navy and returned to the Clyde to take charge of the new Waverley. I duly received my release and returned to the Clyde and was very happy to go down and look at the ship building, my ship actually, as I knew, and I stood by her until she was launched and ready for service. In June 1947, the Waverley was completed and ready for service, and I was a very proud man when I took her out on a maiden voyage to renew the pleasure sailings in the River Clyde, which had been stopped during the war. Now, my ship, the Queen Mary II, was the original Queen Mary, but the name had been given to the Cunard Company on request because they had built a large passenger ship for the Glasgow, New York service, and they wanted to call her the Queen Mary. In return for this gesture, Williamson Buchanan, the owners of the Queen Mary II, were presented with a beautiful framed portrait of Queen Mary, the present Queen's grandmother, and it's hung in the saloon of the Queen Mary II. After sailing in many ships and in many parts of the world, several seas, my heart still lies with the noble sailors and soldiers who went down with the Dunkirk Waverley and lie at the bottom of the English Channel when the Waverley rung her last, finished with engines.